Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming today. We appreciate it. Let's get started with extremely quick intros. I'm Paul, founder of Voxy and English language enthusiast.
Omar, Chihane. I'm founder of Inglese.com and English language enthusiast.
I'm Brigham, Tomco, CEO of Emmersion. We're a language assessment company.
Hi, my name is Joon. I'm from a company called Hallo. We're based in Provo, Utah. We are a community slash cohort based language learning platform.
Hello, I'm Shang from ELSA. I'm SVP of engineering, and ELSA builds a speaking English coach app.
All right, well, it's an honor to be here with these incredible panelists, really the next generation of language learning companies. So let's dive in. One of my favorite lines from our pre-call when we were prepping for today is that fluency is in the eye of the beholder, which I thought was both memorable and provocative. So we all know that percent fluent, which some of these direct-to-consumer apps will actually give you like a rating of what percent fluent you are. We all sort of know that that's not really scientific or very practical. But what actually matters? You know, like John Doerr has that book, Measure What Matters. So with language learning, what does really matter, and how do you measure success in language learning?
So I could jump in and tell you, on the adult education front, it's a lot more in the eyes of the beholder. If we're obviously not talking on a B2B segment, right? Because then the business is paying for their employees. They need clear outcomes. They want those outcomes to be very specific. But if you're a consumer adult, and the measure here is really the lack of confidence if you don't speak English in 2021 in a job market that's a lot smaller and a lot less borders, it's a problem. And so what a lot of our students are feeling is basically they just want to be good enough to get started. And then once they're good enough and they're confident enough to get started, that actually opens them up to even more content consumption online and even more conversations that they're not afraid or shy to start and so on and so forth. And so if I was to ask all of our students, the consumer segment, whether they care or not about their level of, if I was to basically say testing versus confidence, they'll jump on confidence in a heartbeat. They don't care what the level they are. They want to feel comfortable about what the level they are. And as a matter of fact, we have a lot of students that are B2 students, which is upper intermediate, that feel incredibly not confident about their level and they really want to get better. And we have students that are A1 students that if we get them to B1, B2, they get a promotion and they're super happy with it.
So good enough, I guess, really does vary. Brigham, in your business, which is, I think, primarily enterprise, right? How would you answer that?
Yeah, so we work with a lot of B2B companies, and for them, it really is, are you good enough for the job that we're recruiting for? And I think a good analogy is in the hospitality space. If you're on the cleaning crew, you need to know one level of English. If you're going to do the front desk, it's another level, and concierge, it's another level. So it's being able to assess at a level that matches their ability to the job that needs to be done. And similarly with the 600 plus universities we work with, it's about placement and progress into courses. And so are you good enough to be in English 200 instead of English 100 or Spanish 100 versus 200? So there's a lot of benchmarks or cut points that need to be evaluated, as you say, you know, are they fluent enough? It's fluent enough to complete the job that they need to do. And, you know, similar to TOEFL and, you know, Duolingo, are you fluent enough to attend a college and participate well? So that's why a lot of these standards are out there that are put forth. But that doesn't necessarily mean I'm fluent or not fluent. It's I'm fluent enough to do that.
Yeah, and those standards are changing, right? Sort of the high stakes TOEFL may indeed be a thing of the past. Would you guys agree, disagree?
Yeah, I think, you know, single time high stakes assessment in general may become a thing of the past. You know, it's proving our skill and ability in certain areas at that time. And the fact that you had that level at some point in time doesn't mean you currently have that. So I think the whole idea of future of work and education to credential and prove ability is going to be something similar in the language space as well, that you'll continue to credential and get more opportunities as you improve.
I think just to quickly add on a B2B front when we're talking about it, and specifically where they need X layer or X level of English to be proficient at the job. Actually, our first big customer, that was essentially their counter argument. Like, you know, my employees are in Iraq, they don't need English proficiency. Being a Hertzberg student, I went out and said, okay, so what's your employee churn? And how motivated are they? And if you're looking at confidence, when you're talking to the B2B sector, it's directly correlated with motivation. And so it's not just about developing them for what you feel is right to, for them to do their job, is how well they feel it's preparing them for their future career and their future growth and so on and so forth, which then is directly correlated with motivation. Yeah. If they feel like you're just gonna stop it right there, they're not that interested.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. We do a lot of work in the call center, BPO, professional service industries, company like Accenture and KPMG, Teleperformance. And those companies tell us that one of their top reasons for voluntary turnover is the language ability, where those roles require that. And they realize they're not good enough, and so they churn out, you know, of those roles. So it's...
And is that because there's sort of a lack of quality in the testing up front, or just, as you sort of alluded to, it's a point in time and your language ability erodes?
Yeah, so I think two things. One, you know, we're in a space where technology is getting better and new, and the immediacy of data with AI and other things is now being able to be involved real time into decision-making process. So I think a lot of the problem is old process. I think we've seen reports 95 to 98% of language screening for employment is still done person to person in an interview process. So you can imagine the variability. Any one of us five evaluating someone's language ability would have a different range. And so getting standardization and then putting benchmarks, many of our customers don't know what the benchmark is. So instead of saying you need a 7.2 on, you know, a scale or a B1 or a B2, we say let us evaluate, you know, 50 of your employees who are performing the level you need. We'll see what the score is, and then use that as the benchmark.
Interesting. And June, your student base is entirely different, right? These are people that are sort of voluntarily coming together into a cohort without a teacher, mm-hmm. and really just starting to converse, correct? So how would your typical student answer that question about assessment?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, at the end of the day, for us, it's all about practicality, right? Which is speaking and also listening. Are you able to understand in your field? Are you able to communicate with people in your field? So the way we evaluate and assess our students' level is based on, you know, of course, fluency, which is listening and speaking, and also help them understand where they're at in terms of their ability to be involved in that field. For example, let's say I'm involved in business, then how much vocab do I know? How much understanding do I have in terms of vocab or grammar when it comes to speaking the language, which is English in this case? So, you know, for us, we're trying to provide our students with the opportunities to speak and practice as much as they can, because at the end of the day, you know, the best way to learn a new language is by, you know, practicing, speaking, immersing yourself in the culture 24/7 and interacting with real people. So we're kind of leveraging technologies and also the community that we're building to provide those opportunities to people.
Super interesting. So switching gears, we are, I guess, a week after one of the biggest IPOs in our space, I guess, since Rosetta Stone, which was decades and decades ago, right? So yeah, Duolingo went public, and this is a company that, you know, much more similar to a gaming company, started, you know, first with growth as their true north, and then sort of engagement and monetization, and is only now really layering on education. And I started to think, you know, that sort of gets right at the problem. So what problem are we solving with language learning? Are we trying to hack motivation and just get people, you know, motivated, much like you would need to in a gym environment or something? Or are, you know, you guys have all created really, really successful cutting edge learning platforms. Are you trying to hack the effectiveness or the efficiency of learning? And I guess, I don't know, who wants to start?
I'll start. I think the biggest problem we still need to solve is really accessibility. In a lot of part of the world, students can learn grammar, vocabulary, and then do very well with reading. But when you look at speaking English, they don't have teachers who can speak English fluently. And it is almost impossible for any of them to be able to afford having an English coach. and having a technical solution, machine learning and AI-powered speech recognition can make this universally available. That's how we built the ELSA app. And we are able to go down to the phoneme level and score, for example, the TH sound, in addition to our word level, phrase level, sentences level, and give our a score like 80%, like a native speaker. And I want to ask a quick question in the audience. How many of you came here in airplanes? Just raise your hand. So we have a room of brave souls. So the airplane companies want their attendants to speak fluent English to make clear announcements. And they have a human examiners to do the assessment. However, they would rather find a technical solution that's reliable, consistent, and can do it anytime. And this is exactly the solution that we're providing.
Just to quickly add on that, from our side, I don't think we're trying to solve English proficiency. We're trying to solve just for motivation. We're in the adult education space. Our vision is if we're able to be successful in English, we could take the technology in our learning and put that in the health and fitness industry and get someone to the gym. Because if you're an adult and you haven't spoken English with the available in markets where you have internet penetration, so on and so forth, and the proof is in the pudding. We had we tested sending you a notification to come to class. We would have a register to show up at 22%. I send you a notification to come to class, register to show up is at 55%. The only difference is I now made it much easier for you to click and show up to class rather than not. That click made you spend an extra hour in class just by being the kind of, so for us, especially in the adult education field, right? So we're not talking K-12 here. And adult education is predominantly, and if you look historically, any application that has had success or failures has been hacking the show-up rates, or as we called in my previous life in learning and development, bums in seats, right? So you could have a wonderful solution, but I guarantee you, anyone in this room will find 15 excuses, myself included, not to go to the gym. I'm the first one there.
So when you look at your product roadmap over the next 6 to 12 months, or however you want to look at it, with maybe just product capabilities, are you dedicating more to just getting them there than you are to
exclusively
creating pedagogy or curriculum design?
Exclusively. I think for us, English has been taught for hundreds of years. We're not coming to reinvent the wheel on the content itself, right? How you teach the content, but how you teach the content is for them to learn second, for them to show up first, because if they don't show up, they're not going to learn, no matter how good you're. And this is one of the main reasons why Duolingo is such a runaway success, is because it's fun. If it wasn't fun, and one of the things that we constantly tell our teachers, and some educators here will absolutely disagree with me, and that's perfectly fine, but their students and customers, customer service is important, because if we give them an excuse not to show up, they're going to take it, right? This is internal hacking, motivation hacking. This has nothing to do with the way we're delivering. That, of course, is really important to get that right. But I think so much research has been done around the way you're going to teach a language. So little has been done around getting an adult that's 34 years old to actually take an hour out of the, I mean, myself included, I don't go to the gym and it's 30 minutes a day. Right? Then someone has not hacked that yet for me. I'd love to hack that for someone else. So, and I think that for us is really a focus.
Yeah, and I think to add on to that, you know, we're really focused on what's the job to be done. And I think one of the most motivating things is if you realize and help with your students knowing that I have a certain job to be done. Let's say it's, I want to be able to get a job to work in a hotel, or I want to know enough English to be able to take a C# coding class. I think if you can help them understand the job to be done and then tell them we're tailoring the learning to help you get that job done, because I think so many people have a lot of jobs to be done with language and then we push out a generalized learning solution for them and they're learning and learning and playing on Duolingo for months and they still don't gain the skills that they need to fulfill that job to be done. So I think motivation is key, and I think one of the ways we can help motivation is say, hey, we understand what you need to get done. And here's where you're at right now, and here's a roadmap for you to get that job done as fast as you can.
And bite size,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
For us, one of the things that we had introduced that worked extremely well, and just not to kind of promote what we're doing, but predominantly looking at some of our learnings along the way that we didn't think of, was onboarding a student and just asking the question, why do you want to learn English? And basically also get them to tell us how many hours they're going to come into class. This is no different than a personal trainer's MO. Right? So why do you want to lose weight for health? Or how many times are you going to dedicate a week? Great. And then we call them on it. 2 weeks later, hey, buddy, you haven't showed up as often as you wanted. Why? They've prepaid us already. We have absolutely no incentive into getting them to class other than obviously making a bigger impact, which is good for us. But they've paid us already. And that has yielded a 25% increase in show up rates when we A-B tested on hundreds of students, just by asking them how many times you want to dedicate, why do you want to learn, and then just doing a quick follow-up on that. That's it.
Yeah, I think, I mean, as companies, we can definitely cover both motivation and the efficiency of language learning at the same time. How do we do it? How do we do it? I mean, we can teach them English, for example, and also help them learn about things that they're passionate about, right? For example, people come to the United States to go to school here. They learn English, and at the same time, they get a degree, for example. You know, if you think about the passions that you have, you already have that motivation to learn. So, you know, what we're trying to do as a company is to, hey, how can we use and leverage their passions that they have already and combine them with learning English so that they can catch, you know, two birds with one stone at the same time. And to be honest, I'm really happy for Duolingo because I love the company. It's a great brand. You know, they're democratizing language learning at the same time. What they're missing is the practicality though, right? So they're not able to practice, they're not able to interact with real people. That's why they went public, to acquire companies, for them to be able to cover this area. If they're not gonna cover this area, there are gonna be other companies that are covering this area, because at the end of the day, you have to be able to learn, which is what Duolingo is covering, and you have to be able to cover the application part, where you have to use the language, where you have to communicate with other people. That's the part that I think Duolingo is missing right now.
It's a means to an end for us as well. Learning English as a standalone goal is not enough for 99% of our students. One of our most subscribed, and we tested it and we took it off because we had some complaints in the Arab world, but it was English for dating. It was insane. People were all over it. Simply because that was the end goal. It wasn't, they don't care about English. Just tell me what to say if I meet someone.
Yeah, because people learn English, for example, to find more opportunities in life. That's it. They want to go to school. They want to get a better job. They want to get promoted, start a company. So I think, you know, we can really help them achieve their goals that they have, not just learning a new language.
Yeah, so aligning language to a sort of a broader goal, I think that is one way that you can, you know, to use your
resume. It also really depends on the language too, sorry. You know, English is that, and also people learn a new language just because it's a hobby. You know, I think it depends on the language that they're learning.
Yeah, that's true. There's like sort of like hobbyist languages, and then there's also extremely practical languages. I want to segue a little bit adjacent. You know, your whole model is based on community. Is that right, Joon?
Yes.
I mean, yep. No, sorry. Yours is a very community-based approach, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, Joon. Joon. Like the month.
Yeah, sorry about that. And I mean, since sort of the beginning of distance learning, community has been very positively correlated with success, building community around a group of learners, especially when they're at a distance, and we are all sort of in the online world, is a huge, huge difference. So in addition to the making it more practical and purpose-oriented, have you found that building that community of learners early on has impacted sort of levels of motivation and ultimately learning success?
Yeah, so I mean, as of right now, if you look at our platform, we have hundreds of thousands of monthly active users using our product. One of the reasons why we started building this community was because we looked at Facebook, for example, and literally there were over 50 million English learners looking for opportunities to speak. They join all these Facebook groups, they post something like, hey, I'm looking for a partner, who's available? They go to WhatsApp, they go to Skype, they go to, you know, Messenger to be able to practice together. So that's why we wanted to build this company first, so that people can just click on a button, start finding opportunities to speak and practice. And that's kind of how we have been able to grow our community all organic so far. And you know, we're trying to take Hallo to the next level by providing tutors or teachers so that they're not just practicing with other speaking partners, but also they're able to pay to learn from certified teachers and learn about topics that they're passionate about.
And is there data yet to show what type of a learning takes place in that community without a teacher versus when it's instructor-led?
It really depends on the user as of right now. I mean, if you look at our data, I mean, our daily user engagement per day already is 30 minutes compared to 10 minutes at Duolingo. So our users are not just, you know, downloading the app, they're actually practicing and speaking together. And on top of it, we're trying to encourage them to learn from teachers, because at the end of the day, they have to be able to get feedback to learn from their mistakes and correct themselves to really take their English level to the next level.
Yeah, I think there's an element of community that's great for practice, and then the community part that's feedback. When I learned how to speak Thai, I lived in Thailand, and it was great. Everyone that was your grandparents' age would repeat everything I said back to me, but they would say it the right way. And that parroting or mentoring from the community, I think, helps. And so it's great to be a cohort of, hey, we're all learning a language, but then there becomes a limit where if neither of you are good enough to correct each other, you either need to add, you know, assessment into there to be able to give feedback, or have, you know, a teacher or instructor, which you've added to your model, to help give that constructive feedback as you're practicing as well.
Yeah, and interacting with others motivates you to keep going. And also, I think the assessment part is what we're missing as a company. You know, we're trying to help them assess their proficiency level and help them keep track of their progress as much as we can through technologies like AI. So those are some of the areas that we're currently working on.
And do you foresee this getting harder? Like, we're all, over the last year and a half with COVID, have been forced into all of these different online communities, right? Like online happy hours at work, online this, online that. Do you foresee that becoming, you know, I guess, a bigger challenge to drive that sense of community online? Or do you think it'll just keep getting easier as people become more accustomed to it?
I've been able to see some good trends regarding that. I mean, there's got to be a community. You know, we learn a new language because we are in the community that we want to be in. For example, our family, our friends, you know, we learn a new language because we want to communicate together. And, you know, there's a lot of other platforms that are out there that can help language learners build their own communities. For example, Facebook, WhatsApp, literally millions of people using those platforms. But there are still challenges because they're not designed to help language learners particularly. So, you know, what we're trying to do is to, you know, make sure that this platform is for language learning, and we help them get connected with the right people so that they can use their time wisely. For example, let's say we get connected on Facebook, we go to WhatsApp, let's say, hey, I'd like to practice with you. And when I'm available, you're not available. When you're available, I'm not available. And when we get connected, we realize that our levels are different and our passions are different, so they waste a lot of their time. So we're trying to make that process a lot easier so that getting connected with the right people is easier, so that we can help them build micro communities within this huge language learning community.
So we saw a lot of the challenges that Joon just mentioned, and we took a technical approach to compensate for that. So an app that acts like a coach can make it very comfortable for a user whenever he has just a few minutes. He doesn't have to do it alone by himself or herself. And also, since we are online, we build our online communities as well. One technical challenge is that there can be a lot of very tiny communities, but you will have one or a few very large communities. You just have to scale whenever that happens. A community needs to be built by demand. Users need to be motivated to interact. And it doesn't have to be in a specific place. It can be your own app or your own service. It can be around the classroom, around a school. It can even be on Facebook or TikTok, where people naturally come to. That's a great place to start the community.
Excellent. So switching gears, so advanced technologies like AI, ML, you know, VR, AR, et cetera, are clearly changing, you know, everything about how we shop, how we consume media, how we interact with our friends. How do these exponential technologies, how are they gonna change the future of language learning? How do you guys think of that? Do you think of that as something that is an existential threat to all of your businesses, or just incredibly powerful tools to use, you know, to improve outcomes?
For us, we see it as a necessity, because if you're gonna hack motivation, it's at an individual level. We can't possibly do a motivation hacking at an individual level without AI and ML. right? And so, and what we want to focus on is hyper-personalization, but at scale, right?
Just for the motivation.
I mean, obviously, for us, it's first buns and seats. Let us get them in the class. Then while they're in the class, are they learning? Are they continuing? Are they coming back? So on and so forth. So all of these questions, we could answer those questions on the macro when we are right now, but being super successful would mean that we would need to answer those questions at a micro, meaning our entire kind of journey down to, if I was to look at a macro, it would be, people go to class. Why do we all go to class? I did my MBA a couple of years ago, 5-6 years ago. Why did I go to class? I loved the people in the class. I really liked the teachers, so on and so forth. But what really motivated me was the entire environment, right? It's not just about the content. It's not just about the teaching. It's not just about the teaching style because you are an audible learner or so on and so forth. It's also about the classroom chemistry. And so over time, hacking motivation also means that you get the teacher you want, or the teacher type you want, with the classroom chemistry you like, the learning style you respond to, the time you want the class to be at. All of this stuff could only be enabled with machine learning and AI. And then you have a dynamic system that offers you things that we know you specifically would respond to.
How about you, Brigham?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of research that shows that the best way to learn anything, but particular language, is in a one-on-one tutoring model with an expert to an individual. So that's awesome. And we try to look at how can technology make that kind of scenario happen for the masses? How can we democratize that? So I think two big components of that one-on-one tutor model are immediate feedback that you can give and a customized learning path. And I think those are two things that AI and technology are leading towards, that if we can give them immediate feedback, they're working on the things that are going to bring them to the next level most. And language, different than many other domains, needs to be done in order. There's a pedagogy to learning language, and if you've skipped some skills, it will be hard for you to ever progress, later on past certain levels. And so being able to have the ability to assess immediately and then create paths that work at their pace, to me, is where I see technology enabling us to get those full benefits of that one-on-one tutor model that just isn't practical for most of the world.
So AI and machine learning is merging further with the traditional language learning. Any company in this space who doesn't adapt this will be left behind. And if you look at what technology is able to do, it's no longer just a pronunciation word stress, but it's also not just feasible, but there are new products, startups that are putting into real world use to evaluate the more advanced skills, such as the confidence level that you render giving a speech or being inclusive leading a meeting. And we're going to see this more. However, I want to share a story of an English coach. At the beginning, she thought ELSA is a threat, but she ended up recommending it to all her students because she found that ELSA can be used any time when she is not available. And we have our school teachers assigning homework to the kids as well, even before we are able to have a dashboard showing the homework status. They just ask students, open up the app, and then show that indeed the homework was done there. So this is how I see technology is mingling with the traditional language learning.
I really like this quote from Jeff Bezos of Amazon. He said, never lean away from the future. Always be friends with the future, right? So, I mean, the way we look at it is, how can we be friends with AI? How can we be friends with technology? Because we know language learning, online language learning particularly, is the future. So, all the other benefits that have been talked, also along with them, I think, we're using AI to be able to monitor the content, what's happening. For example, if you're streaming, if you're teaching, how can we moderate that? And if somebody exposes himself or herself, we close that down, automatically. All the other applications that we can do to be able to make the experience as safe and also pleasant and effective as much as we can.
And do you guys see sort of really low latency translation? I mean, if you look at what speech recognition, you know, text to speech, et cetera, all these things can do now, can you see a world where less people want to learn a language because it's just not needed?
Probably not. It will change how people learn language. For example, when translation is seamless, that will reduce the need for a lot of people to learn the language. However, I think people's ability will actually increase, ability, not effort. When another language is just like a dialect, I expect more people will understand more about other languages, and this is what AI technology is able to bring us.
I think if you were to look at it, a language as a standalone, i.e., I need to learn English to be able to send an email, then yes, that, you know, the fact that you have that seamlessness. But if you're looking in, if you look at it at a more raw level, career progression is predicated on communication skills. Period. Communication skills bedrock in business world is English proficiency, period. This isn't about whether you could hack it or figure it out with as low latency as possible. This is whether you can do it alone, standalone, right? And in a presentation format or in a negotiation format or in a salary discussion format, so on and so forth. And I think that for us is where we feel, because for those of you who know our story, we started off me saying exactly that. I went on social media saying English is not that important, guys. It's going to get hacked really soon. It blew up in my face. I had a couple of million people telling me you're crazy. A couple of million views and a couple of thousand people telling me I'm crazy, how English would change their life. And for me, it's English is predicated on people want to speak 100 words fluently and without any accent over speaking or knowing 500 words. Because this is a lot deeper, because when I did that, I really felt like I was offending people, right? And you only offend people by really going at a core of their insecurities. Yes, AI and synchronous, let's say, translation will change the face of learning the language if music culture is not in English anymore, if movies are not in English anymore, so on and so forth.
People listen to English language music without understanding the English, and they enjoy it quite a bit.
But not understanding English is actually rooting at their insecurities as they're doing that. So they're so attracted to it.
In 2021, I might agree with you, but in 2035, I'm not so certain.
Yeah.
Yeah, some interesting data. We're in B2B, so I would just hear what I hear from our customers. But outsourced call center, for instance, is a $300 billion market projected to go to $500 billion. But that market has been one for the last 5-10 years that our chatbot's going to take over our business. And the spend is saying no, at least in the short term. 2035, I can't see out that far. But I think what we realize with technology, there's a human element to learning and engaging that people still enjoy. So I've always been a big proponent of let AI enhance the capability of the human teachers' interactions and make those higher quality and let the asynchronous interaction. So if it's a chatbot, the early parts of your phone call for support need to be there. But when I do get on a call with a person, I actually am going to demand their English to be even better when we get there. So I think it's how do we use AI in learning, but also in the practical uses of language to enhance the interactions we have and make those better, because there's more time and more money to be put on the human interactions, because we can inexpensively take out part of the learning process with technology.
So AI, I think, eventually will replace a lot of jobs, especially those routine and less creative side. So anything that AI can do for 70 or more of it, there's a chance for the job to disappear. However, for English learning as a whole, I expect AI is able to do 30% of the job. That's when it will enable human beings to are more focused on the creative side to be more productive. And we're talking about not just translation, but also be a good communicator, understand, and to be understood, be someone and with communication expertise that connects two cultures together through a different language.
I think just as a last point to close off that argument, specifically for us, we want AI-enabled teachers, or MLM-enabled teachers, which means that if we're looking at a classroom, we want our classroom to be 1,500 students, all of it synchronous, but every single one of those 1,500 feels it's a one-on-one session. And because their feeling of how one-on-one session is how often they're being poked by the teacher. Well, that poking could automatically be done. The question could be coming from the teacher, but it's actually a chatbot that knows exactly what questions to ask when, or what question to answer when, and so on and so forth. So as you start leveraging AI and ML, I don't think the teacher interaction is gonna wait out. I think it's predominantly how do you make a teacher become more present and add more value on an online classroom session leveraging AI and ML.
That makes no sense. We're getting short on time, but any of the panelists, thank you guys also very, very much for your contributions today. Any closing thoughts or summaries?
I guess just a thought that we've talked about a little bit here that I'm passionate about is that the future of education is getting to personalized learning paths that get people to their job to be done as fast as possible. And I think that's been one of the biggest frustrations in the industry is, you know, I've learned English my whole life since I was in kindergarten, you know, and I've lived and worked in multiple countries in Asia and throughout the world, but I still can't speak 12 years later. And I think that frustration is something that we can help improve as an industry, focusing on what they're trying to accomplish, it personalize that path for them and find a way for them to certify they have the ability to do that. So that's what we're trying to do, at least.
Yeah, I mean, as an immigrant who's learned English, I can tell and I can say that learning a new language can change someone's life, and it will open up so many doors, and it's a new passport to new opportunities. So that's our vision, that's our mission. Like, we really want to help people to be able to find opportunities in life and also dream big through learning a new language. So, you know, I love language learning, you know, whether it's through Hallo or not, I'm gonna be continuing to be in this industry helping people.
So just from my side, I haven't learned English at 17, probably a lot like you. I could tell you I was, and having had a big backlash on social media, I was the first person to take English for granted, right? And I think that it's very important for anyone in the room that is English proficient to understand that if you do not speak English today, it's a serious problem. And I think solving that serious problem is very, very critical. But I think what's really also important is understanding that those who don't speak English fluently are likely in also markets that are a little bit more traditionalist as well. So learning a language with a teacher is also something that's very important, because, you know, try to convince them to learn online is one thing. Learn them to learn online from a machine is another, right? So I think, you know, understanding that the teacher from our side, we're a teacher-led company. So teacher comes first, enabling the teachers to basically be able to give more impact to their community, whether it be in math or in English or in physics, is part of, an integral part of our mission and vision.
So the speaking English or speaking part of learning any language was the most difficult part to automate. But now this is the time for technology to shine again with the help of AI and machine learning. And it will more mingle with language learning, and possibly in a way when most people don't even realize it. That's what we should expect.
Excellent. Well, thank you guys all once again for a great panel. Thank you all for your time and attention today. And have a good conference.